remember what the prayer was yesterday. I'll think good thoughts. I'll say good things. I won't say what I really want to say.
We all know him as a man who speaks his mind. Deputy Majority Leader John DeFrancisco joins your voice. I'm Julia Lilkindy.
That was a little bit of a misquote. I couldn't quite tell myself to, you know, watch what you say, because I just say what I think is right. But there was a Buddhist priest who gave a nice sermon the day before. And so I was trying to keep things a little cooler than mine had otherwise been, and it turned out fine.
Yeah, so that was your bill to create a commission on prosecutorial conduct.
Correct.
And when you said you were retiring, I asked you, what bill would you want to make sure gets enacted if you had your choice? And you said this bill.
Yeah, this is long-ranging effects. And basically what the bill is, it's a bill that provides a remedy against prosecutors that are not following the rules. And it happens. There's people going to jail on murder cases where evidence is being withheld, or even lesser cases where evidence is being withheld. And the law says you got to disclose it. And there's some instances where people have stayed in jail for years, 10 years, 20 years, and ultimately by DNA evidence, they're proven not to have been the case, the perpetrator, and that DA's office had documents that would have shown it and information that would have shown it, which is just pathetic. Well, we've had a judicial misconduct committee, judicial conduct commission since the 70s. And that's the reason it went in, basically, an avenue for an independent evaluation of alleged misconduct by judges. When it happened in the 70s, everyone went apoplectic. All the judges thought it was the end of the world, but it wasn't. As time went on, it changed judges' conduct. So they followed the rules because there's a threat of some type of consequences. And that's all it is. And the DAs also now are going up, getting very upset about it. But it's not an indictment on any DA. It's a review process for those who aren't following the rules.
Right. So people did say that they thought this might politicize the process.
They did. People can say anything they want to say. But that's not the case. This case is it provides an independent body. The Judicial Conduct Commission is not politicized. They're political appointees, just like in any commission that's appointed. You can't avoid that unless you want all prosecutors on it, but that's not the way it's supposed to work. So it won't be politicized. And all I can point to is the Judicial Conduct Commission, and all the evils that are being raised just did not happen. And all the concerns over time showed that it worked.
All right. Let's show part of the debate where you're answering whether there's evidence that there's an uptick in misconduct by prosecutors.
After the DNA rules were broadened to provide more DNA samples upon arrest for certain offenses, yes. And whether there's an uptick or not, this has been happening without consequence. And every single person should be subject to consequences and responsibility for their actions.
Will the sponsor continue to you?
Yes.
Is the sponsor aware that the New York State Bar Association's Task Force on Wrongful Convictions found 53 cases from 1964 to 2009, and that is 0.004 of 1% of all convictions?
I don't know that for a fact, but it would not surprise me. The prosecutors also told me that they are being reviewed, and there's punishment on the books. There's plenty of oversight on the books because they're subject to going before the grievance committees in each county. If anybody knows of a case where a prosecutor actually went before a grievance committee and anything happened, I'll give you $10, okay? I asked the prosecutors that 3 years ago. You say there's a sufficient remedy? There's a sufficient remedy? Give me one case. And what, you know what they told me? They said, we'll bring up tons of cases. Last year, nada. This year, nada.
Talk about that for a minute.
Well, when this bill was first put out 4 or 5 years ago, there was always this mantra that there is a remedy. Why create another one? And they claim that the grievance committee of the State Bar Association, which meets in every judicial district, not every county, and is a remedy. Nobody's ever prosecuted. Nobody's ever reviewed. No prosecutors are ever reviewed. And the reason is that there's local committees. They talk about politicized. The grievance committees locally are comprised of lawyers in the locality. And most lawyers in the locality practice law, and many of them practice criminal law. Can you imagine going to a DA to try to get a client a plea bargain because the evidence is weak after you've accused the DA of wrongdoing? That's why it doesn't happen. Secondly, the DAs found a situation about the second year when I was trying to get some examples.
When you had the hearing and it got a little loud at that
moment. Yes, we did have hearings. So those that you didn't hear that argument, which usually comes up, we should have had hearings. Well, we had hearings.
Right.
But the grievance committee, there was this DA in St. Lawrence County that had all things going on and showing misconduct, at least allegations of misconduct. So they said, I'll show you how we do these things. And the president of the State Prosecutors Association said we're going to file a grievance against her. Terrific. So the following year, after they filed the grievance, I said, how's that going? He says, well, we haven't gotten any response yet. I said, I rest my case. I mean, it just isn't a remedy. And besides, it's got to be an independent body. And again, not to try to find problems in the prosecutor's conduct. It's to remedy those situations where it's actually shown.
Mm-hmm. Checks and balances.
That's true.
So at a news conference last week, I heard that. Did you write a letter to the District Attorney Association and then didn't even get a response last year?
I got responses, but the responses indicated that what they said was the case they didn't have any evidence of. So they've always been responsive. They've always been very well willing to meet with me. And in fact, I think the reason it got on the floor, the group wanted to see John Flanagan a couple of years ago. And we had a meeting in John Flanagan's office. And I raised all these issues. And they gave the answers that I just indicated. And he's also seen that this isn't the case, what they're saying. So hopefully it'll get passed by the assembly, signed by the governor, and over time there's going to be fits and starts as we start this process, just like with judges. But in the long term, there's going to be, when you know you got oversight, you're going to be less willing to take risks about your reputation and how you handle your responsibilities.
Right. Another reason for pushback was it'll be a drain on time, resources, and reputation of prosecutors. But if you've gone to any of your news conferences and you see the people who are wrongfully accused and their devastating stories and their time, their reputation.
Well, it's a little difference when you balance things in government. You balance inconvenience and time versus time in jail for years.
Yeah.
The cases that have been shown over the past, and even in the minor offenses, even if evidence is withheld in order to get a conviction, and evidence is withheld, even in minor cases, it ruins somebody's reputation.
Mm-hmm.
So I just think it's a good bill, and fortunately, a majority of the Senate felt it's a good bill. It was more than 2-1, almost 3-1.
Yeah, actually, 44
more than,
to 12.
Yeah, actually more than 3-1, and around 3-1. And then Democrats and Republicans, it was a great debate because all sides weighed in. It wasn't a party line vote. Mm-hmm. And now it's going to go to the assembly.
Right. So what do you expect the assembly to go?
I would hope so.
I
would think so. Yeah. They've been just as interested in getting this bill on the floor as I have.
So New York has an opportunity to set the course for the country, really, in this.
Well, it could set the course for at least prosecutions in the state of New York. And I don't think by following the rules, you're going to have less convictions. And if you do have less convictions, it's because you don't have the evidence. And that's what the rules are supposed to result in. So I know the prosecutors are not happy with me, and that's part of being a legislator. You can't make everybody happy. You got to do what you think is right.
Right. There have been numerous ways since you have been a legislator that you have pushed for accountability and more transparency. And that is our look back today to 2000, the year 2000.
Well, I think the legislature has made a mistake by not continuing the authorization to have cameras in the courtroom. I think the people have a right to know what's going on in a court proceeding. Perfect example is the Diallo matter that occurred in the Bronx, where a defendant or a person arrested was shot, and now four police officers are on trial. That trial was moved to Albany County because judge down in the Bronx felt the officers would not get a fair trial. There's no reason the people in the Bronx where this occurred should not be able to see what's going on in a courtroom concerning their community. So I think we should really open up the courtrooms by legislation. The trial judge in that case has by his order opened up the courtrooms, but I think the legislature should allow this to happen in any trial.
It's 2018. Still hasn't happened. Mm-hmm. Still hasn't happened. Even all the years that have come across my body, 18 years or whatever it was, 2000, and it's a shame. I had a trial, a murder case, that we went to trial on, and I was defending in that case. I was a prosecutor in the military and a defense attorney in the military, and then did both on the in the civilian side. And there was, at that time, was the discretion of the judges, and there was allowed courts cameras in the courtroom. And it was, once you get going, the concept is it's going to end up in more theatrics and it's going to be like a TV show rather than, but once you start trying a case, your mind is running as to what you should be doing in that case. And you don't have time to think about all the you don't get distracted because you don't, your mind is so heavily tuned in on what you're supposed to do in the courtroom. Mm-hmm. So, but still to this day, they've not allowed it.
Yeah, from just a spectator view, I would be interested in seeing some court cases.
Well,
sure.
The infamous O.J. Simpson trial was televised, mm-hmm. and televised for months. And, you know, there were people glued to the TV.
Yeah.
You know, like this was better than some reality TV show because it was reality. Mm-hmm. So I don't know. I think it's a good thing. And the whole concept is you're supposed to have public trials. And there's no courtroom that's sufficient to accommodate a large crowd in the event that it's a very high publicity or high notoriety type case. So this is just an extension.
Mm-hmm. All right. So you would also like to see more transparency in state contracts.
That's correct, and we passed some procurement bills, and we got another one that that is on the calendar, and hopefully we can get that passed as well, and then the assembly will pass them.
All right, and 5 years ago, you were lobbied by a fourth grade class. They were studying state government. Take the story from here.
Well, the class, one young lady was so involved in her science classes that she believe that she found out that the state of New York does not have a state amphibian. We have a state everything else, even a state muffin. That came about by my predecessor, the apple muffin. It happened from a school in North Syracuse in my district. And she felt we should have a state amphibian, the wood frog. And what was great about it is all these kids started lobbying me, sending letters, coming to see me, coming to Albany, and they were really, really enthused. Now, it came on the floor one other time, and it was a big joke. You know, it was, oh, what are we doing at this point in time? We're towards the end of session. And it was, and I kept trying to say to them that that this is an educational experience for these kids. Mm-hmm. We've done it before. It's important to them, just like any other lobbyist might have an issue that's important to them. So that came on the floor, ironically, the same day as the prosecutorial conduct bill. And I was kidding after both of them passed on the same day. I was kidding that the only reason I brought the prosecutor conduct bill on is to screen away any kind of concern about the wood frog bill. They forget about it, which was truly not the case. So she's been notified. She's ecstatic. And hopefully the assembly will pass it. I doubt it, though. They don't think it's important. They think it's a joke. But I'm going to give Assemblyman Engelbrecht one last shot because there was a beautiful article in the newspaper about it and about the participation of these kids in government, and I'm going to walk over to the chambers and say, hey, look, you know, what's wrong with this? You know, why can't you do it? And so we'll see what happens.
Well, maybe it will help to show a picture of those sharp kids from back in 2013 when they talked to you about designating the wood frog as the official state amphibian. The girl in the front row, second from the left with the pigtails and purple shirt, is the young lady you were talking about, Lily Winkleman. All right, so it's the last week of session, and your last week.
Last week of session, that's correct. My last week actually is the end of December,
right?
Because we could come back, but we're still a senator, still a senator till the end of the year. We could come back. God knows what else will pop up. Yeah, other things are going to pop up, I'm sure. But as a practical matter, once session is over, there may be a few extra days in the fall, but I don't think it's going to be that substantial. So, you know, I have mixed feelings about it. You know, obviously, I've been part of this place for 26 years. I've enjoyed what I've done. I think I've contributed something. But on the other hand, the more and more time I have on my hands, you realize that it's not an easy job, and it's a constantly on your mind. And it'll be good, at least for a little while, you know, to just basically do what my wife and I want to do. And in next month, the 13th of July, it's our 50th anniversary. So she's put up with 41 years of me in government.
Wow.
And but she's never, ever complained, never said anything that would discourage me. In fact, encouraged me to go for the run for governor. I don't know if that was her thinking that I'd be a good governor, or that she didn't want me around as much if I was home with her all the time. But so it's been a great experience. So I have mixed feelings, but the time is right.
After watching your debate last week, it was apparent, and I heard it from many people, is what are we going to do without him?
Well, I've heard that a little bit too, and it's a very good feeling, but they'll survive. Just to remind everyone, there was a fourth grade class in my district that was studying amphibians and found out that there was no state amphibian. And as an exercise in government, and that's the only reason I'm doing this, they lobbied me, they wrote me, they came to Albany, they came to New York, and here now they can see that government does work.